Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. I just want to say it was good to have my good friend Julie Delateri back on. I'm going to make sure I have her on more. It's Wednesday. That means Wednesdays with my good friend, Executive Director Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. Good morning to you, my friend. How are you?
I'm good. How are you, world? We've got snow now. The cold weather coming.
Yeah, you know, it's always good to have you. I want to begin by talking about what is it about the state of Wisconsin that we are just always so late to things. This now a debate about whether or not this should be medical marijuana. I can tell you that at least 10 years or so or more ago, there was a conversation about medical marijuana, and a young man, disabled young man that my wife and I have been raising for over 20 years, was taking so many different medications and for seizures and other things. And so we were looking to pursue medical marijuana. And I remember going up to Madison and having a conversation with legislators, Republican legislators. And they thought that I was, you know, that we were crazy. And that this didn't make any sense because it may lead to recreational marijuana. The rest of the nation had already long since passed that, you know, medical marijuana issue long before they legalized it. What is it about our state, Dr. Kraig, that we can't seem to deal with things that are sensical, and we become nonsensical in the way we address these things?
It's this is a few times, Earl, where I think it's a very simple answer. We have a legislature that doesn't represent the people because they chose their own voters rather than their way around. And so the Republican majority in both houses of the state legislature is an outlier, not only nationally, but with the public. This is the polling in Wisconsin, upwards of higher 70s, close to 80% support legalizing marijuana. Are traveling to neighboring states. Michigan, Minnesota, and Illinois have all done it, and they can get away with it because they've been able to sit in undemocratic districts.
But Dr. Kraig, for heaven's sakes, I didn't even say legalizing marijuana. I was talking about we haven't even legalized medical marijuana.
Same thing. I was talking about full legalization.
Yeah, I know.
This is sort of like I'm for the first step in emancipating American slaves, African Americans, was to ban extension into new states. This is sort of like they're back at extension when we're at full emancipation, right? It's that kind of thing. The rest of the country and three surrounding states have legalized marijuana. And we haven't, not because the public doesn't want it, not because people are traveling and paying taxes in our neighboring states in order to get it. It doesn't seem to matter that factually this gateway drug theory is a myth. It's no more of a gateway drug
than alcohol
is.
I know.
And it's not more dangerous than alcohol. It's different. They both have dangers, but banning them, prohibition,
or tobacco,
doesn't work.
Or tobacco, for heaven's sakes.
Yeah, and it's driven mass incarceration by having this. It's a taboo. It's literally, it goes back to kind of unscientific pre-modern ideas that they're able to hold on to because we don't have a real democracy in Wisconsin, because if the lawmaking power of the state is controlled by one party, period, this is the result.
You know, Dr. Kraig, you and Citizen Action, you have co-ops all over rural Wisconsin. What are you finding out in your conversations with rural Wisconsin about these kinds of issues that clearly people want to see changed?
Well, one interesting thing, other than people don't think anything will change, right? Because it hasn't, right? It's certainly, right. It's very popular in rural areas that these Republican legislators claim to represent. But it's not like voters have a clear choice, right? It's not like when there is not another candidate that can actually defeat an incumbent, then what's the point? And so it's not even, the strange thing about it is it's not even really framed up as a voting issue. People need to understand that very few issues come to the top of the fore where the public is actually making their decisions about candidates based on them. And this could, it has that kind of power. It hasn't shaped up that way. I think if we get better maps, and it's exciting just seeing the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel story on some hypothetical maps, then there'll be a lot of people running on this as part of their platform, and then voters will get to know that their representative is standing in the way of even medical marijuana, and that it doesn't have to be that way. And by the way, it could be a major revenue source rural areas, simply because you could grow marijuana in addition to the tax benefits of doing it. So we could more adequately do things like fund our public education system, fund our historically great but terribly underfunded four-year universities, and continue to fund our tech colleges, which are under increasing threat from this undemocratic majority.
Well, you know, they've led people to believe that marijuana equates to crime, right? I mean, you know.
It's superstition. It's taboo. It's not based on anything. And there are a lot of stereotypes. People think, the leaders, not most of the public, that it's all young people and people of color. Right. And it's like, you remember the movie Reefer Madness? It's like Robin Voss and his cohorts still believe in it. It's because the kind of people that can be elected when they don't actually have to stand in real competitive elections for re-election and actually have the voters assess whether they share their values or not and their policy.
So it looks like they're not even going to be able to get the medical marijuana bill passed.
Right. It tells you something about the kind of, these aren't real public representatives because they don't actually have to stand for election, Earl. And so this is a kind of authoritarianism. It's not one authoritarian, right, where you have the dictator. It's a bunch of them in legislative seats who just are allowed to let their personal taboos and prejudices damage the public interest and not be responsive to public opinion. It's a very small minority of the state that is opposed to this, but it controls the legislature.
Let's do this. Let's go to Bill from Oconomowoc. Good morning to you, Bill. How you doing? Thank you very much for the call. You say what?
Great show as always, Earl. So you said something, Earl, that just blew me away, and I just had a call. You said that they believe that marijuana equals crime, yet they don't believe that guns equal crime. Isn't that amazing? I mean, you can be there. We know they don't live in the world of reality and they have their own rules, but one leads to crime and the other doesn't. I don't get the comprehension. If they can't recognize the real value of marijuana, they probably can't even recognize the value of indoor plumbing. That's that old.
All right, Bill. Thank you very much for the call. Like I said, you know, Dr. Kraig, even if I was to buy, you know, what Robin Voss said about, you know, well, if this is going to lead to, you know, legalized marijuana, he basically said that's going to happen over my dead body. The truth of the matter is, again, all of these people with cancer and all sorts of other maladies who has been proven that medical marijuana, it works better than all the drugs they take. How can you justify not giving the people an opportunity at the medical marijuana? How is that possible?
You can't. But you don't have to, because these folks have not faced real elections. And I agree with the caller. And here's the thing. I want to be respectful, right? There's, you know, a small part of the population that earnestly believes that all marijuana should be illegal.
Right.
There should be a conversation with them. We should try to find common ground, but that small minority shouldn't be able to dictate to the whole state an outlier policy. That's really, I mean, this is really retrograde. This is sort of like, we're not going to do women's suffrage in this state. I'm going like back 100 years,
right.
But we'll allow women to participate in some other way short of voting. It's just like, no, and they're not even going to do that, right? That tells you how retrograde it is. So we do need in a democracy to have people come across difference, talk across values, and find common ground. So I don't want to, the reason I'm being hyperbolic about this is because of their willingness just to impose their own minority view on everyone else. I mean, it's an authoritarian attitude. It's like the corporate leaders who said back in the day, I won't be any union at my facility over my dead body, or segregationist governors who said, you know, segregation now, segregation forever,
right.
George Wallace, right, et cetera. It sounds like that kind of talk, and that's an authoritarian attitude. And our maps have allowed people with those sort of attitudes to have the kind of power Robin Voss has.
So, Dr. Kraig, when we come back, we got to take a short hiatus. We want to talk about the maps. You know, because the Republicans, I don't know if they've already created it, but their time is running short. 844-967-2789. Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action on the Earl Ingram Show.
So you're heartbroken. You sit around moping, crying, crying. You say you even thinking about dying? Well, before you do anything rash, dig this. Everybody plays the fool sometimes. There's no exception to the rule. Listen, baby, it may be factual, may be cruel. I ain't lying. Everybody plays a fool. Ooh. Falling in love is such an easy thing to do.
All right, welcome back. The Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. My guest is, as always, on Wednesdays, Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. You know, Dr. Kraig, the maps. So the legislature is supposed to have drawn the maps by now. I don't know. Do you think they've already drawn them? Or are they choosing not to draw them, knowing that they're not going to pass?
Very unclear. They're supposed to draw maps. The Democrats are. There's the Supreme Court majority in the state has hired a couple of outside experts to assess them, and if none of them are adequate to draw maps themselves, which they've done. In Pennsylvania and Virginia, I think, are two of the states that these two experts have worked with. One is a professor. One is actually a former student of this professor at a University of California school, I believe. And so the original signal was they put out kind of this whiny statement that they needed more time. But I haven't seen it, Earl. Maybe I missed something in the media. I don't think there's been any other further communication other than that they want the U.S. Supreme Court to intervene. The plaintiffs in this case did a very good job of avoiding all federal constitutional and statutory issues. But it's like Voss and the Republicans are pleading for divine intervention from the U.S. Supreme Court. And I use that because these folks claim to be Christian despite their very unchristian values in terms of their fellow human beings, right? And so I don't know whether they submit the maps or refuse to. It's all going to be based on what activity by them could trigger a U.S. Supreme Court intervention. Maybe they're going to draw maps in a way that they think does that. I'm not sure how that would work. So they have a lot of firepower behind them, a lot of right-wing law firms, a lot of corporate lobbyists, right? The big corporations are aligned with these folks. Just understand they're the power behind the throne, the Wizard of Oz behind the curtain, right? And so they're going to come up with something. I do not know what their calculations are. We really won't know until we see their next move. I don't know if I might give enough credit for chess, Earl, but at least we got to wait for the next checkers move.
Well, you know, Dr. Kraig, they're kind of checkmated because just listening to Robin Voss and the legislature, in the last 10, 12 years, I haven't heard them ever feel as if they weren't in charge and in control, and they always spoke from the authoritarian perspective of things, but not now. So they must just about know that the jig is up.
Yeah, the linguist at University of California Berkeley, who was very popular for a while on messaging, George Lakoff, wrote a lot about the conservatives being kind of organized around a strict father model, you know, for a view of the family.
Right.
So they think they're the strict father, and just think of any Hollywood movie or fiction about what happens when the strict father who expects and authoritarian control within the household has it challenged, right? They certainly do not act well, and they act out, and they may act brutally. I don't know what levers they have other than the U.S. Supreme Court, and I don't know how lawlessly this U.S. Supreme Court might act, right? And it doesn't, you only need four justices to take a case, and that could gum everything up. You also need one to intervene on the rocket docket, so to speak, without any briefing. That's what happened last time, and that's Amy Comey Barrett, which is not fill anyone with confidence. But we didn't know last time what the excuse for intervention would be. So perhaps they invent another one, or, I mean, really, I don't want to sound conspiratorial like the Trumpies and the QAnon crowd, right, Earl? But you do wonder if the far right of the Supreme Court, the Clarence Thomases, are actually in communication with top lawyers in the Republican Party that are in communication with Voss, and they have some inside information on what might be the way to get the Supreme Court to take a case.
Well, and the fact that they would have to take it, you know, almost immediately, elections are around the corner.
Well, if they take it and stay the state Supreme Court, they could force, if they delay it long enough, the old maps to stay in place for another cycle.
But let me ask you,
what Trump is trying to play for with all of his delay tactics, which we saw on display yesterday in those oral arguments before the D.C. Circuit.
So let me ask you,
federal judiciary.
Let me ask you, Dr. Kraig, it's not just Wisconsin. Rigged maps have been all over the nation. Would the Supreme Court just take an individual case or take a case collectively and look at all of them, as opposed to dealing with them individually?
They've already refused to take on partisan gerrymandering as an issue. So they should have. That case came from Wisconsin. It should have, based on all precedent. It's an affront to any notion of democratic rule to allow this sort of chicanery and rigging. But they did. So they've claimed that the states are in charge, right, and state Supreme Courts, but then they've intervened in several different places. They've intervened, you know, in Wisconsin in a negative way to come up with a whole new reason to go just with one judge, Comey Barrett, to overturn the last maps 2 years ago. But they have also intervened in a more positive way when states such as Alabama and North Carolina have gone so far the other way, refusing to, you know, the underrepresentation of the large black populations has been They've lost decisions on that, and the legislatures have still tried to ignore it. They've actually come down on the other side. So they preserve some level of credibility. There's some behavior that you can't engage in, but that is all about disenfranchising very large black populations, and that's not the situation with the Wisconsin map.
All right, 844-967-2789. My guest is Dr. Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. You can join us on the other side. Us at 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. It's Wednesday. That means Wednesdays with my guest, Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. So Dr. Kraig, I think it's important that we talk a little bit about your co-ops, and because especially, in the twinkling of an eye, the elections are going to be here, and how people can join those co-ops, where they're located, and the importance of them.
So we have organizing co-ops, and that is they're membership chapters. So they're local, and they have professional organizers that live in the communities and work with them. And they work with each other across the state and with the whole state organization to win elections, but also to push serious policy that's going to improve people's lives, with a big focus. Our biggest focuses are on health care, which we think is a fundamental right we need to make progress towards, and a climate transition, because we have a climate crisis that also dramatically improves economic equity and opportunity and recreates a broad middle class that includes everyone, which we have dramatically declined in Wisconsin since the late 1970s, when corporate America and a lot of politicians that went along deindustrialized this country, and all of those great union jobs left not just Milwaukee, but places La Crosse, Wausau, Racine and Kenosha, just at Janesville, just everywhere, right across the state.
Right.
The northeast of Wisconsin is a big industrial center, too. We were a major industrial state, and it was high-level manufacturing. A lot of it was machinist work, so it took a little longer than some places that were more, that weren't
that physical
as advanced
labor,
as far
right.
as the level of the worker. And it was deliberate corporate policy to abandon the places that made them their money and made them what they were and seek cheaper labor, and they bought the politicians who enabled it. And so we have this opportunity where we need a mass number of new workers. We don't have enough workers to meet the climate crisis, even to meet what the workforce needs of what President Biden's already passed, the huge climate investments he made in the Inflation Reduction Act, let alone what the further steps we need to make. And so we work on that around the state, and our organizing co-ops, which anyone can join, are spread across the state in small cities and in Milwaukee and they include the surrounding exurbs and rural areas. So you can see these as connected. So the La Crosse area, our Driftless area co-op, the whole Chippewa Valley area centered in Eau Claire, the North Woods centered in Wausau and Marathon County, but the whole seven county area, and Northeast Wisconsin, Green Bay and the Fox Cities.
You know, Dr. Kraig, we've got radio stations in all those areas.
I know, and then Milwaukee. So, right. And in Milwaukee, we have multiple because there was an original organizing co-op that was created that was really white progressive activists across the city and the region. But then we've built one in the north side of Milwaukee as well, Northside Rising, which is African-American led and run and has African-American organizers that are working with them. Because you have to do that. You have to bridge the racial divide in American politics and in Wisconsin politics and the urban-rural divide in order to do things like actually guarantee everyone a right to health care instead of having a health care system that is completely grounded in profit and not in people's health and their lives. That's why it's so expensive and excludes so many people. Even people with insurance can't afford the co-pays and deductibles and all the surprise medical bills, and therefore avoid medical care when they're insured. So, but in this 2024, we work in elections, and we are committed to the idea that you only rebuild democracy if you make elections a participatory sport where people stop just going online or watching cable news or radio, though we want them to listen to Civic Radio Network, don't get me wrong, Earl, when they're driving to volunteer in elections or, you know, arriving to work, etc. But that's the only way to rebuild democracy, and that's the only way to change hearts and minds. Television ads, the dueling television ads, and all of the slime on social media doesn't do it. What really moves the ball is people in their own communities talking, having deep conversations with each other about things like you brought up earlier, Earl, like why the heck are we the only one of the few states that hasn't legalized medical marijuana, and the growing number of states that have completely legalized recreational marijuana as well, including Illinois, Minnesota, and Michigan. But people need to have conversations about that and who's in the way.
So, you know, Dr. Kraig, as you know, you travel around the state and you travel around the country, but around the state, and you go to different rural parts of, you know, the state. And so what are the conversations that are you know, the most important that people are discussing?
Well, people are worried about the future of democracy, as President Biden is. That's why he gave, when he announced his campaign recently, I think an excellent speech on the threat to democracy in his launch speech, which if people didn't hear, you shouldn't just read a couple quotes. You can look at it online on YouTube.
Yeah, he
and
was
watch the whole thing.
He was fabulous, actually.
Yeah, no, that was Joe Biden at his best, and that reflected, you know, the canard that somehow he is less qualified than Donald Trump to be president because he's a couple years older. Since you hear Trump's various ramblings and his behavior in the courtroom yesterday and afterwards at his press conference. But there, you know, people are confused as to why why our democracy doesn't work beyond the question of why is there a threat to even the mechanisms of democracy. And so, people are unclear why we've not expanded magic here in Wisconsin and gone beyond that. Why we have a Republican legislature that has made us one of the laggard states in the country on transition to renewable energy, to solar and wind and creating green jobs. And so people need to be inspired to see that we can not only save democracy, we can make democracy work again if people get involved. And so that's what we're dedicated to doing. Democracy is voting is only the beginning of being a good democratic citizen. It's being involved directly in your community and the people shaping public policy rather than the lobbyists. If you talk to Earl, the average legislator, even the ones that are our allies going in and think they're going to go and change everything, they're shocked at how loud the voice of all the lobbyists are from the various interests and how faint the public voice is at our state capitol.
You know, Dr. Kraig, it's almost, people act sometimes as if these things, they can't defeat it. You know, it's almost insurmountable. They feel like they can't defeat it. But hang on a second. Let's go to CJ. Good morning to you, CJ. You say what?
Well, thank you for taking my call, you and
Dr. Kraig.
Dr. Kraig. You know, I believe that there should be medical marijuana for people who need it, truly need it.
Okay, but it's not there. In Wisconsin.
Well, I'm saying that it should be, okay? And I'm a Republican. So, but there's people, I know of people, factual, that have gotten a medical marijuana card somewhere else, which it's a joke. So,
I know, so, but, okay, you know, so CJ, let me ask you, let me ask you this question. So when I hear people say they know somebody who got a medical marijuana card and it's a joke, you dismiss all of the other people who need it and who can't have it because somebody says they know one person. And so people are being denied this because somebody says they know one person, and then they make a statement, broad statement, like you just said, it's a joke.
I'm listening to leader boss. I'm listening to what he's saying and agreeing with him that people who truly need it medically should be able to get it. The question is, we're surrounded. We're an island. We got recreational down all around us. So people can go get it if they really truly want it.
Well, why should they have to go get it? Why? Well, I'm not talking about recreational. We're talking about medical marijuana. And Robin Voss and Republicans have held that up now for well over a decade.
Do you believe there should be recreational?
Absolutely. If there's alcohol and if there's tobacco, yes.
Okay.
People have a right. People should have a right in this nation to determine whether or not they want to smoke a joint.
They have a right to drink
as much as they want to. That's okay.
You can do that in Monona, the suburb of Madison, and pay a dollar fine.
Well,
you can smoke a joint if you really want to, Earl.
It's illegal.
I wish Dr. Kraig would address this, what's going on today, because we're seeing people die by the airplane load every day in the United States from fentanyl.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the call, man. We're not going to change the subject, okay? We're not going to do that. Dr. Kraig, you want to respond to what CJ said about...
Yeah, I'll take on the right-wing story about fentanyl as well. But obviously, Earl, most Wisconsinites think that marijuana should just be legal, okay? Nearly 80%. So obviously, TJ is in the 20%, right?
Right.
The one question is when he says he's good, he's a very attentive citizen, he's listening to Robin Voss, and Robin Voss is concerned about, says he's concerned, who knows what he's really concerned about, you know, he's willing to do medical marijuana if it's only for the people who truly need it, okay? And this is like on the abortion issue. Then we get down to who decides. And apparently, and it seems like the answer usually is that Robin Voss and politicians decide, rather than just writing a law that says it has to be prescribed by a doctor.
Right.
I mean, and leave it to medical professionals. They won't do that because then we'll have conspiracy theories about one doctor that was supposedly abusive. It's a little like the old welfare queen story that was one woman and mostly a canard, right? That Reagan used to tell. And so there's great stuff if you look that up and look up the actual history of the woman from the early 70s. That
yes.
Reagan made stand for all welfare people, everyone who needed
the welfare,
a little help,
the welfare,
you know?
Queen, the welfare queen.
Yeah. And so on fentanyl, look, think about what fentanyl shows is, because fentanyl is being added to illicit drugs, is the problem with the drug war and outlawing all these drugs. And it shows the selectivity of Republican freedom. They believe in freedom for things they want to do, but then they believe in their freedom to prevent other people, right? And so if we had legalized, regulated drugs beyond marijuana, we would not have a fentanyl crisis. And it's not a supply issue. They keep saying it's somehow connected to immigration. This is just a clever conjoining of issues in order to ramp up their desire to maintain an immigration crisis, not really solve it, and then to capitalize on it politically by revving people up based on hatred of people who they see as they're made to see as different than themselves.
Dr. Kraig, hang on. All of you on the lines, hang on. 844-967-2789. My guest is Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. Join us at 844-967-2789. Text us at that same number. My guest is Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. Let's go to the phone lines. And Susan from Kenosha. Good morning to you, Susan. You say what?
What I say is that they should legalize marijuana. People are smoking it and have been smoking it for years. And if they want to get it, they can drive down to Illinois, they can go all over.
Which makes no sense.
Makes no sense. So why don't we legalize it and sell it, and then we can tax it, and it's a win for the state of Wisconsin. And that way, people who need it medically or for other different purposes, it's used in the treatment of psychiatry, it's used
glaucoma,
different kinds
glaucoma,
of
all sorts
glaucoma.
Of things.
Glaucoma.
Yeah.
Yes. So let's legalize it, and let's also, we can control the type of marijuana that it's not used in any other different purposes. And yes, it's like the old story with alcohol when they
prohibition
banned alcohol,
right?
Prohibition, people found a way to get it. So let's legalize it and let's move on.
Hey, Susan, thank you very much for the call. Dr. Kraig.
Well, Susan is completely right. And the reason we don't do it is because we don't have a democracy in this state. So
yeah, that's really at the root of it. We don't have democracy.
Yeah. So Donald Trump thought because he won one election, he should be able to hold power in perpetuity. Robin Voss and the Republicans did win one election that was very much on their ground, the 2010 election, which was nationally a big gain for Republicans, the Tea Party moment there, and have thought and have so far been able to get away with the idea, therefore we get to control the legislature
permanently
through every election because we won one in 2010 under very good conditions for our side. And so that's why, because there's authoritarian control of the legislature. It's an authoritarian attitude. And I know we could have all sorts of, that's not authoritarianism. You know, it is not one dictator. Ultimately, you have a small minority of state opinion dictating to everyone else that we will not do something that the surrounding states have done, right? And that we will tell fellow citizens that you have to live by our moral code. And, you know, conservatives and the evangelical movement always acts like the left or mainline Democrats want to go and persecute their beliefs. No, the question is, we need to work together and come to a consensus and go with majority rule unless we're violating one's rights when it deals to public questions, like what is the law? No one is saying that any conservative, that CJ or anyone else or any should have to smoke marijuana, right? It's just, why do you get to decide whether someone else can?
Hey, Dr. Kraig, well said. Let's go to Mary from Wauwatosa. Good morning to you, Mary. Mary, you're going to talk about marijuana?
Oh, yeah. thanks for this conversation. I'm definitely for medical marijuana. There's a lot of suffering that's going to be relieved if people have access to that. Now, my concern, my reservation about the recreational is that we have a lot of impaired drivers on the road between alcohol and, you know, cell phone use. Is this a legitimate, so if we have recreational, is this a legitimate concern of mine, and what's the remedy for this, or what, you know, what positive do you, or how can you reassure me about this concern?
We thank you very much for the call, Mary. I hate to tell you they're already on out. driving impaired by marijuana. Dr. Kraig?
Yeah, I think that's it. And this is the Mary's concern, is the kind of thing we should have, an honest, open conversation about, right, in our democracy,
right,
if we restore it. But I do not believe, from what I know, that the states that have legalized it have seen a large uptick in impaired driving. Impaired driving is a problem with alcohol as well, and also with some other prescription drugs,
right?
And so I do think we don't invest very much in preventing it, right, and educating people about it, and should invest more. If you go to Illinois, and I do, my parents both live in Illinois still, they have the kind of ads and billboards about impaired driving when you're on marijuana that you see in public service ads in Wisconsin about alcohol. But we shouldn't, I don't think that prohibition solves the problem, right? I think I agree with the concern, but I think that's not the solution. The solution is to really invest in a system that minimizes impaired driving as much as possible. And we could do, we do some of that, but I think we could do better, even better.
You know, Dr. Kraig, I think out of all the things that you said, you just nailed it. Why does somebody else get to have the right to determine, you know, your rights, right? I mean, what you can and what you can't do, you know, listen, if people choose to want to smoke a joint, I don't think it should be criminal. I never thought it should ever be criminal. And so that's what it's been, right? And people have finally come to the realization that criminalizing marijuana was stupid. And yet here we are in Wisconsin still at it.
Yeah, it's like if we had ended alcohol prohibition state by state and we were in one that was refusing, right?
Right.
I mean, it took a while for the blue laws to go away. Remember, there were a lot of states where no alcohol sales on Sunday, et cetera. That took a while. But ultimately, we can't just allow a small group of people just to impose their values on everyone else. Conservatives, a lot more of them used to believe in that kind of individual self-determination. They don't anymore. It's become a authoritarian movement at the moment.
Hey, Dr. Kraig, always great stuff. We'll reconnect again shortly. Dr. Robert Kraig, Executive Director of Citizen Action. Thanks, Julie Deleteri of Singing Trees Farm, and you, Calvin, and everybody who made the show go. Up next, Jane Matnair.